So I want to, as an example of working with triangulated categories, I want to describe the construction of a quotient. So this is somehow going to be analogous to the procedure when you have a abelian category and you have some subcategory stable under extensions, quotients, and subobjects, then you can take quotient of abelian category by this abelian subcategory and get a new abelian category. So with derived categories, there is a similar process. So if you have a subcategory, so let T be a triangulated category. So then, so we say that a subcategory C is a triangulated. So we always consider full subcategories. So it's called. So it's called a triangulated subcategory. If it is closed under, if C is closed under shifts, and under cones. So what does it mean? So under shift, it's clear. So if you have an object in C, then shifted object also is going to be in C. But under cones, so we mean here that if you have two terms of an exact triangle are in the subcategory, then the third object is also in the subcategory. So now, if you have a triangulated subcategory, there is one more definition. So a triangulated subcategory is called a thick subcategory. It's called thick. If it is closed under direct summons. So if you have x plus y is in C, then both x and y are in C. Right, and so then the claim is that so this construction is due to Verdier. So if you have a triangulated category and a thick subcategory, so then one can define a quotient category together with the functor, with exact functor. So this will be triangulated, and this will be exact functor. And it will have the property so that C will be exactly the kernel of this functor. So meaning that this is all objects which are sent to zero. So this is kind of made mostly into exercises. So let me just indicate into exercise six. But let me just indicate that this actually this is actually particular case of localization construction. So given, how is this defined? So So given this subcategory, we define a class of morphisms S in T. So this will be a morphisms XY such that when you consider the cone, then this will be in C. Yeah, and so the claim is that this is a, so this is one of the things you need to check in this exercise, that S is a localizing class. And then we define this quotient category to be the corresponding localization of T. Now, one thing I want to show here is why S is closed under composition. So why? Yes.
Do you mean it is closed under sum within C, then all sums are in C? Is that right?
Yeah, so if the direct sum is in C, then each summand is in C. Yeah. Yeah, by the way, it's from the fact that it's closed under cones, it follows, of course, that it's closed under direct sum. Because you have a, so if you take a cone of zero morphism, this will be y plus x shifted by y, one. And also it's closed under shift, so it's closed under finite direct sums. So why S is multiplicative? So this is, I wanted to show, because this is proved using octahedron axiom. So suppose you have a composition of morphisms which are both in S. So you have yeah, so let's write this octahedron diagram. So we have this maps to Z. So suppose both these maps are in S. So this is an S and this is an S. So then the octahedron axiom tells us that, yeah, by the way, nobody asked why it's called octahedron. So one can indeed place this diagram on octahedron, but I'm bound to two-dimensional pictures, so I cannot draw this. So in Gelfand-Manin, you can try, there is an attempt to draw this picture on octahedron. Right, so so the point is that we know that this is in S, so therefore this guy is in X prime is in C, right, as a cone of morphism in S, and Z prime is in C. And now we have here an exact triangle. So in this exact triangle, we see that two terms are in C, this term and this term. So therefore, the third term is also in C. So here you need to use the shift of the rotation of the triangle. So yeah, by the way, when I formulated the axiom about rotating a triangle, it should have been an equivalence. So this triangle is exact if and only if the rotated one is exact. So you can rotate actually both ways and still have exactness preserved. So right, so you can, so if x prime is in C, I can put like x prime shifted by minus 1 here. So we have here both guys are in C. So therefore, because it's closed under cones, y prime is also in C. And that shows that the composition of the morphisms is also in S. So x to Z is in S. Right. So, for example, if T is a homotopy category of complexes, then we can take a C acyclic complexes, a subcategory of acyclic complexes. And then you immediately see that, so this is triangulated, it's closed under shifts and cons. So the fact that it's closed under cons follows from the long exact sequence. Yeah, so whenever you have an exact, yeah, so whenever an exact triangle in homotopy category, there is a corresponding long exact sequence of complexes. So if two terms are acyclic, the third one is also acyclic. So that's why it's triangulated. And thick also because if the direct sum of two complexes is acyclic, then so the cohomology of direct sum is sum of cohomologies. So you see that both x and y have to be acyclic. So therefore, this is a thick subcategory. And now if you want to see what is the corresponding quotient category, so the claim is that this is precisely derived category. So K of A quotient by acyclic complexes. This is precisely derived category because what is the corresponding class S? So the class S is precisely quasi-isomorphism. So when you have morphism between complexes, it's a quasi-isomorphism if and only if the cone is acyclic. Again, by long exact sequence of cohomology. So the construction of derived category can be viewed as a quotient by acyclic complexes. Yeah, so somehow this point of view is used in various generalizations of the notion of derived categories. So you try to, when you, for example, when you have some kind of different categories, and you don't have abelian category and have some other kind, you can try to find some interesting subcategories to take quotient by, and this is actually one of the constructions of the so-called derived categories of the second kind, which I don't know whether they probably won't show up because Nick is not a big fan of homological algebra, but but they're related to matrix factorizations. So the derived categories of the second kind, where you kind of they're also defined as appropriate quotients and were shown by Orlov and Posicelski to be related to the categories of matrix factorizations. So, right, so here is, this is an example which I will tell more about on Monday. I don't have much time to discuss this now, but if you have an admissible subcategory, let's say in derived category of coherent shifts on some x. So that's kind of referring to yesterday's lectures. So is thick, and the corresponding quotient can be identified. So it can be identified with either right orthogonal, but it also can be identified with left orthogonal. So in fact, there is a canonical equivalence between the right orthogonal and left orthogonal, which I think wasn't discussed yesterday, but it actually, in particular, it follows from this.
I think the functor here, but we didn't discuss.
Yeah, the functor is called mutation and through C. Yeah, so this will be a kind of, we'll discuss on Monday in more detail. Now, the example I want to consider next is a geometric example. So where you have So suppose you have a variety X and you have a closed subvariety. And then, or maybe closed subset actually, Zariski closed subset, and then you have a complementary open U. So then I can consider the derived category of coherent sheaves on X, and there is a natural, let's call this inclusion J from U. So there is a natural restriction functor J upper star, which is exact, so you don't need to derive it, just apply it term-wise, to derived category of coherent sheaves on U. And it turns out that this functor is kind of this type. So you can describe this category as a quotient of this category by the kernel of this functor. So what's the kernel of this functor? This is actually easy to understand. So this should be complex. So this was an exercise in the first day, but the complex in derived category is zero if and only if all its cohomology are zero. So kernel of J star, so this consists of complexes here such that when you take cohomology of restriction of F to U, then this is this should be zero, right? So in other words, this is the same as if you take first take cohomology, because J star is exact functor, so it's the same as if you first take cohomology. So here I just mean sheaf cohomology. So you take ith cohomology of the complex F and then restrict it to U, then it becomes zero. So this is equivalent to stating that every cohomology of F is supported on Z. So, and this is just set theoretically supported on Z. So if you take the ideal sheaf of Z, so this means that this coherent sheaf is annihilated by sufficiently high power of the ideal sheaf of Z. Okay, so for example, if Z was a divisor given by some equation F equals zero, so the fact that this sheaf is supported on Z means that it's killed by sufficiently high power of the equation F. Right, so then, so let's call this, so this category is, let's denote it as D B Koch X with support, and put here Z, so this is guys supported on Z. So then the claim is that D Z Koch X is thick, and we have equivalence of quotients. So this functor induces an equivalence. The restriction functor induces equivalence with derived category of sheaves on U. Well, actually. So maybe a remark that the same holds on the level of abelian categories. So we also have that if we consider abelian category of coherent sheaves on X, we have a subcategory of sheaves supported on Z. And so this is a serre subcategory, and there is an HL equivalence with the category of coherent sheaves on U also. So mostly it's so there is two parts in the proof of this. One is geometric and one is abstract. So the abstract input is the following general lemma about quotients. So if you have, so suppose f is, let f be exact functor between triangulated categories. So then it induces, so considering, so assume that the induced functor from C mod kernel of F to D is full. Then it is also faithful. So let's call this functor f bar. Then f bar is faithful. Full means surjective on morphisms, and faithful means injective on morphisms. So let me not, before I prove this lemma, let me explain how I want to prove this. So in fact, in my case, not just f bar will be faithful, will be full, but actually the functor from derived category of Cahen shifts on x to restriction functor is already going to be full. So basically, so instead of checking that something which goes to 0 is 0, you only solve some lifting properties. So you need to show that some morphisms in this category can be lifted to morphisms here. And yeah, this is actually very easy to see. So this follows immediately from the fact that this functor is exact, right? So indeed, why is kernel is thick? This is because, so if you have an exact triangle, so suppose you know that, so you apply f to it, and suppose you know that f of x becomes 0 and f of y becomes 0. So then this triangle is still exact. So if an exact triangle, two terms are 0, the third term is also 0 by uniqueness of the cone. F is additive, yeah. Yeah, whenever I say exact functor, it's assumed that it's additive. Yeah. Yes, and also if you have direct sum, if f of direct sum is, yeah, this is probably what you were asking about. So if f of direct sum is 0, then because this is f of x plus f of y, then this implies that both of them are 0. So. So yeah, so in this general situation, if in addition I can prove that f is essentially surjective on objects, then combining this with faithfulness here, I get that this becomes equivalence. So if in addition f is essentially surjective on objects, so this means that every object is of D is isomorphic to something in the image, then f bar is equivalence because it's fully faithful and essentially surjective. So this is also, to check this is also some lifting question. So you need to lift a complex of coherent sheaves on an open subset. You have, well, not lifting, extending. You have to extend it to coherent sheaf on X. So, and So let me, before proving this lemma, let me show you how it is used in this example with open and closed, with a open subset. So there is a very well-known statement that, so if you have a, let's say, call it fu, so a coherent sheaf on U, then there exists, so then there exists a coherent sheaf on X such that it extends this sheaf on U. So how do you, so let me quickly remind you how this is done. So there is always, so we have this embedding, and there is always a quasi-coherent sheaf you can consider. So this is a quasi-coherent sheaf. On X, which has this property that its restriction to U is just the original sheaf, FU. So what you usually do is you're trying to find your F as a subsheaf here. So basically you, because F is somehow finitely generated, you just kind of locally leave these generators here and consider if F is sufficiently large, then this would work. And you kind of you construct it by kind of adding enough things locally and then extending them. So so in particular, there is actually a slightly stronger statement, which says that you can not only construct this F, but you can, if you have any subsheaf, any coherent subsheaf of this sheaf, you can make your F to contain it. Right, because whenever you have a subsheaf here, its restriction is always going to be a subsheaf in FU. So you can only win by adding more things to FU, to F. Right, so now, and then you can do this for complexes. So if you have a complex, so if F is a FU complex, bounded complex, of coherent sheaves on U. So then you basically do the same thing. So you take the push forward. This is a complex, this is going to be a complex of quasi-coherent sheaves. On X. And then here you're trying to construct, you can construct a coherent subcomplex of coherent sheaves. So you just have to make it large enough. And this is actually a very simple construction. You have to construct, you start from the right. So you have like, I don't know, let's say this is the last term of the complex. Suppose it just zero after that. So then you first find a subcomplex here, which is subsheaf here, which is sort of large enough so that its restriction is the original sheaf F not U. And then, so then in here, you already have the preimage of this one. So now you can construct the sheaf F1. So So this is going to be a quasi-coherent sheaf with the property that d inverse of fu, f0, when you restrict it to u, it's actually going to be the entire fu minus 1. And so you find your f minus 1 as a coherent sheaf in here. So this is still quasi-coherent. But it has the property that its restriction to u is the entire sheaf f minus 1. So it sits in here, and it's already big enough. So then you can find your coherent sheaf as a subsheaf here. And then you kind of proceed kind of as further. So then you take preimage of this one, take a coherent subsheaf there, and so on. All right, so that's how you can lift the complexes of coherent sheaves on U to complexes of coherent sheaves on X. And there is a similar argument for morphisms. So if you have a chain morphism of coherent sheaves on U, so any morphism in derived category over abelian category you can represent by replacing the complexes to quasi-isomorphic one, you can replace by an actual chain morphism. So then you lift this to, so then you kind of have to, I think you first lift F to, so then you want to show that there exists a kind of lifting, there exists a chain of complexes of coherent sheaves on, so this is on U. So then you want to construct coherent complexes on X such that and a chain morphism between them such that it restricts to this one. So what you do is you first, right, so you again use this quasi-coherent complexes here. So we already have this morphism between J lower star of fu dot and J lower star of gu dot. So what we do then is we first construct a coherent subcomplex here, which is which restricts to Actually, we need something slightly more precise. So here, in checking fullness, we actually cannot, we cannot there change the quasi-isomorphism class of F. So in fullness, we have to check that we start with F and G, and then we have some morphism between the restrictions. And then you have to lift this to, and then you have to extend it to X. So what you do then is you, right, so this is actually F restricted to U. And so in here we already have F. So basically what I think you do is you have to just take the image of F under this morphism. So it will be kind of J lower star F of F in here. And then you will need to construct G here. So there is a kind of G in here. And so you will need to construct this G prime, which contains both this and this, and which is quasi-isomorphic to G. So this kind of becomes messy, but it's really not very, it's really just some explicit construction with complexes that you can easily do. And so this shows that the corresponding functor from this quotient to derived category of coherent sheaves on U is full and essentially surjective. So this from this general lemma, you get that it's an equivalence. Now, how do you show this general lemma next? So you need to, so we started with some morphism. Suppose you have some morphism in this category, which becomes zero. Right, so. Right, so basically the first idea is that I can, I can just work with f bar directly. So we'll get that the, so replace, so proof of lemma. So we can replace C by C quotient by kernel of f and f by f bar. And then we can assume that the kernel of f is zero. So we then just have a functor from C to D, which is full and has zero kernel. And we need to show that it's also faithful. So it's full exact functor. So suppose we have some morphism in C, which goes to zero under F. So let's call this morphism F. So the induced morphism from f of x to f of y becomes zero. So we need to show that this map is, we need to show that f was zero. So what we do is this. So we extend it to an exact triangle. So then the image of this exact triangle will be fx goes to fy, goes to fz, goes to fx of 1. And because this map is 0 by one of the exercises, this becomes a split exact sequence. So this is, in fact, fy plus fx of 1. Right, so this means that there is a splitting of this, there is a retraction, so there is a retraction here. So there exists a map from fz to fy such that if I go first from fy here and then go back, then this is identity. So this is a split direct summon of fz. So but now this map from fz to fy, by fullness, it comes from some morphism from z to y. And so I can use this morphism. So let's call it S. So here, or maybe project, so it's a projection, right? So let's call it P. So it's a, so its image is going to be projection. So then this gives me a map from Z to Y direct sum plus of Z Y plus X of 1. So I use here as the second component, I use this map, and as the first component, I use just this project, this z, which maps to this projection. So now, if I look at this map, its image under f becomes an isomorphism. So when I apply f to it, it becomes a map from fz to fy plus f of x 1, which is an isomorphism because this is how we chose this projection. So we chose this projection so that it corresponds to the splitting of fz into this direct sum. So, but if this map becomes an isomorphism using exactness again, so the cone of this morphism goes to the cone of this morphism. So the cone of an isomorphism is zero. So we obtain that the cone of this morphism goes by f to zero. And because we assume that kernel of F is zero, it follows that this is an isomorphism. So we call this alpha, so then we get that the cone of alpha, F of cone of alpha is zero, therefore cone of alpha is zero. So alpha is in fact an isomorphism. So therefore this is an isomorphism, and therefore we get, so our map from Z to Y has this proper, well, so this implies that that F has to be zero, again by the, so cone alpha is zero, so from this we derive that F is zero. All right, so I have one more example which is also elaborated more in the exercises, and it has to do with, there is also some kind of quotient construction there, but it's a different quotient construction. So it's actually one of the ways one can construct, so it's a different way of constructing triangulated categories. So far, the only examples of triangulated categories we have were either homotopy categories of complexes and various localizations of them. So we can, localizing by acyclic complexes, we get derived category, and then we can consider various quotients. So far, this is the only class of triangulated categories, the only examples of triangulated categories we constructed. So this example gives you a different type of construction of a triangulated category, which is actually also somehow related to matrix factorization. So this has to do with so-called stable category. So it's a very general context. So it's stable category of example of a Frobenius abelian category. So Frobenius abelian category, this is abelian category in which so the projective objects are the same as injective objects, and there is enough of both. So every object can be embedded into an object of P, and for every object there is a surjection from an object of P. So an example if you have a finite dimensional Frobenius algebra, so Frobenius algebra means that there is a functional so over some field. So Frobenius algebra means that there is some functional tau from A to K such that when you consider the corresponding pairing tau of XY, so this is a pairing on A, this should be a non-degenerate pairing. Should be a perfect pairing. And example of an algebra like this is an exterior algebra. So if you take an exterior algebra of a finite dimensional vector space, so you take tau just to go from the top which power to k, and so then the multiplication in the exterior algebra, when you take this this kind of product, and then this is well known to be perfect pairing. Yeah, so then, the point in this is that in this case, there is an isomorphism of A with the dual of A, and as a module, and so when you so for finite dimensional algebras, the dual of A over K, this is going to be injective modules. So this shows that you have a class of projectives, and injectives are the same. So I think this example of so I am now going to explain the construction of a triangulated category starting from this data. So I think the original construction was precisely for this case. So it was a stable category for the modules of exterior algebra. So the category here is the Frobenius category is the category of finite dimensional modules. Right, so if you have a Frobenius abelian category, then you consider the corresponding stable category, A bar. So it has the same objects as A, and morphisms are defined as follows in A bar. So this is, you take morphisms in the original category, and they take quotient by those which can be factored through an object of P. So you take quotient by all the morphisms that can be factored through some object of P. So all such. So this P is projective and injective at the same time. So these are in the case of exterior algebra, this class P, this is just going to be all free modules. So for this particular algebra, this is just free modules that you have. So you quotient by those morphisms which factor through the free modules. So this is actually a very surprising fact that this can be equipped with a triangulated structure. So claims is that A bar has a triangulated structure. And so there is some indication in the exercise number 9, how the construction goes. So first of all, the translation functor, it's kind of comes out of nowhere. So the translation functor is defined as follows. So how do you define F1? So what you do is you embed your object A into an object of P, into a projective object or injective object, and then you pass to the quotient. So, and then it turns out that this quotient in the stable category, it's already uniquely defined and it's functorial. So it turns out that this is a definition of the shift. So it's so basically what you have to show is that if you have another object and you have you embed it in projective, then there is actually so given a morphism here, so there is, you can construct some morphism here, and the induced morphism that you get on quotients does not depend on any choices. So it's going to be unique morphism in the stable category. So all the choices will cancel once you take quotient by this subspace. And so there is a similar construction. So there's also an exercise that's indicated how the triangles work in this category. So if I have time next week, I'll probably try to explain that in this example with the graded with modulus over exterior algebra. So the stable category. Stable category for the exterior algebra exterior algebra. Well, with slight variation, so you have to consider graded modules over exterior algebra. So you have to remember that the exterior algebra has a grading on n. So we take exterior algebra on n generators. Yes, so we have xi1, xin, skew commute. Is actually equivalent, it turns out, to derived category of coherent sheaves on Pn minus 1. So this was discovered around 1980 by Bernstein, Gelfand, Gelfand, and it was kind of one of the big impetus for studying the derived categories of coherent sheaves in general. So it was kind of at the same time when Bailenson's description of this category appeared. Anyway, so I won't talk more about this now. So in the remaining 5-10 minutes, I will talk about, I will start talking about generators. So, and especially about split generators. So this is actually, so we already used a little bit the words that some objects generate the entire category, but somehow this is most, the category, the framework of triangulated categories is the natural place to talk about this. So suppose we have some triangulated category. And suppose we have some family of objects, some collection of objects. So we say that these objects generate T as a triangulated category. And some people just say generate T, but unfortunately this is sometimes misleading because there is a second notion which I will formulate now. So I'll try to say as a triangulated category, if the minimal triangulated, minimal triangulated subcategory containing these objects is the entire thing. Minimal triangulated, so it's kind of triangulated envelope of these objects should be the entire category containing all GI is T. And so the confusion here arises because there is a second notion which I'll call split generate. But unfortunately, in many standard references, the second notion is just called generate. So split generate T if minimal thick subcategory is entire T. So if thick envelope of this of GI is T. So if you take minimal thick subcategory containing all GI, then it's the entire T. So in other words, so in the first case, I just start with this objects and I consider all their shifts, and I consider all possible morphisms between objects I get and consider cones, right? And then can continue doing this. So I generate more and more objects by considering various cones and shifts and so on. when split generate, there is one more operation that's allowed, namely passing to any sub-summoned. So if you have, you generate, and then you suddenly got an object which is, which is decomposable into direct summoned. Then you're allowed to pass to one of the summons. So that's the only additional thing required here. But you will see in a minute, I'm going to consider examples, that there is a huge difference. So you can, most reasonable categories, you can just split generate by one simple object, whereas generation as a triangulated category takes, it takes much more effort. So. So when Nick was talking about full exceptional collections, so in this case we require that the objects generate everything as a triangulated category. But in some cases it's actually equivalent. Well, so this is I'll probably explain this next week. So here is, so there is an exercise about this, which I will write. So if gi split generate some category t, then if I consider left or right orthogonal to this collection, so this means all objects such that home from these guys to this object is zero, or home from the object to GI is zero. So this, these are all zero. And there is actually a third notion of generation, and the third notion of generation is in terms of orthogonal. But I think Nick already discussed with you that it's actually not equivalent to anything like this, but the third notion of generation is also used, somehow it's also useful, but it's useful in conjunction with some other assumptions which I don't want to discuss now. So you have to consider compact set of generators in categories where infinite sums are allowed, and then somehow there is a connection between this kind of generation and the second one, split generation. So, but this is not, I'm not going to discuss. So I'm going to discuss an example. So there is a very simple construction of a split generator for any smooth, if we have any smooth projective variety. So, and let's take some ample line bundle on it. Maybe let's take very ample because I want to. So we just embed it into projective space and take corresponding off one. So then the claim is that if I take the object G equals O plus plus L plus L square, etc. And then I stop at some finite place. So if I take sufficiently large, sufficiently many consecutive powers of L, then this is a split generator. Then this object split generates. The entire derived category of coherent sheaves on X. And in fact, the reason I chose L to be very ample, in fact, it's enough to take N to be equal to dimension. To take N equal to dimension of X. So for example, if you have a smooth projective curve, you just take O plus a very ample line bundle, and they already split generate everything. So the proof goes as follows. So let's see the thick subcategory thick envelope of G. So maybe I'll just write it like this. So thick envelope. So the minimal thick category containing thick subcategory containing G. So the first claim is that all powers of L are there. So first claim that so all powers of L are there. So here you don't need direct summons, you just need some exact sequences of on projective space. So on projective space, so L is the pullback of O of 1 from X. So L to the N is pullback of O n. So so on projective space, we have exact sequence of the following kind. We have let's start on the left hand. So you have O goes to O of 1 to the M plus 1. Then O to the 2 to the M plus 1 choose 2 and so on. So it ends with O of N to the M plus 1 and then O to the M plus 1. So there is this is just absolutely exact sequence. So it corresponds to taking the sections x naught through xn. So this there are n plus 1 sections of O of 1. And so you have so it's kind of the corresponding Kazule complex, and it's exact. So now, right, so now, so this sequence, you can use twists of this sequence. So the sequence shows that, for example, Om plus 1 lies in the triangulated envelope of O of 1 up to O of n. And it also shows that O lies in the triangulated envelope of O of 1, O of 2, etc., of M plus 1. So it shows that if you have M plus 1 consecutive powers of the ample line bundle, then you can get the next one to the right and next one to the left using cones. So here I seriously use the fact that the short exact sequences always extend to exact triangles. So for example, to show this fact, right? So when I take the image of the map, so I kind of split this into short exact sequences. So then this is isomorphic, quasi-isomorphic to the cone of this. So it's in the triangulated envelope of this pair. And then I proceed further, and eventually I reach this one. So therefore, so if you have kind of sufficiently many consecutive powers of the ample line bundle, then you get all the other ones. So you use this fact, and you use twists of this fact. So you also tensor by O of I. And then you see that you can get all the powers of the ample line bundle there. And the second step is a little more interesting. And I'm unfortunately, it's time to eat. Okay, so I'll keep the intrigue here, and I'll tell you the next step after lunch. So yeah, we still have 10 minutes to think about things, about exercises, and then we'll.